Hey class, it's Bill back with the third video in the Chapter 4 intro. I hope you're having fun with these videos and feeling like you're getting the hang of repetition structures and what they can do. It's neat stuff, I think, and I'm having fun, so we're on a roll, so let's continue. We've covered all of the topics here: types, running totals, sentinels, input validation loops. The one remaining thing is nested loops, so let's jump down and let's cover that. The concept here is that sometimes you need to have a loop inside of a loop, and you can have them more levels deep than that, but it's not atypical to need two loops, one controlling one level and one controlling a second level of things. If that's the case, basically, if you think about it, if you have one loop inside another loop, the inside loop is going to run more quickly, it's going to finish its stuff, and then the outside loop is going to then go to its next value, and the inside loop is going to run again through all of its stuff. So basically it's a series of a slow loop on the outside and a faster loop on the inside. Hopefully that makes some sense if you think about how nesting would work and having a loop in a loop. So, but to understand it more specifically, let's do an example, which is, let's say that you have a kid who's trying to memorize multiplication tables, and you want to have a little study aid so that you can print them out anytime they need it, a little multiplication table up to whatever value they are interested in. So let's jump over and let's start it, and we'll do a little concept before we go forward. So in this case, let's do, you know, we know we're going to do this multiplication business, so we're going to create a function called multiplication table, and they get to pass in whatever you want the max number to be. Now, in this case, we know that for the multiplication table, we can use a for loop because these are going to be counter-based, right? You're going to go from 1 to n, and you know that's counter-based, so for works perfectly. We don't need a while. So the concept here is we're going to have a for something or another, and then within that for, we're going to have another something or another. Now, what I want you to think about is the fact that whatever's in this outside loop, it's going to start this loop, and then it's going to do this loop, but this loop has to completely be finished before we increment and get back to the next value up here. So this, whatever's in this, is going to be the slower loop. It's going to tick by a little bit slowly, whereas this one ticks by more quickly. It's going to iterate and do all of its stuff before we then come back here again. That's the concept of the slow and the fast loop. So in a multiplication table, right, this is what we want. Let's sort of do some thinking here. What we want is to have, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then we want to have values here, 2 times 2 is 4, 2 times 3 is 6, right? We want this kind of idea that we want the output to look like. So how do we make that work? Well, we basically have to do rows and columns, so which one is which thing here? Well, if you think about it for a second, the way that we display things on the screen is from left to right. So the whole idea is going sort of row based, and for each row you have to print each column. Think about that for a second. The row concept is the slow loop concept, and the individual items that go in the column is what's going to have to be ticking by more quickly. So by that logic, you can understand that we're starting with the rows in the outside loop, and we can use a range because we know how far we're going. Right now, in this case, do we want to start with 0 for our first value? Well, probably not. We probably want to start with 1, and then how far up do we want to go? Max num, whatever the user passed into this function, right? Whatever the caller sent in. But as we saw in an earlier video, if we don't do this, we're going to make a mistake and we're never going to get the top value that we really want, right? We're going to stop one short. So the outside loop says, hey, if you asked me for the 12, a multiplication table through 12, that's what I memorized when I was in, I don't know what, fourth grade, something like that. If you want it 1 through 12, we got to start with the row, and we're going to go from 1 to 12 rows, but within that, we need to also print each column's worth of data. So what's this going to look like? Well, it's going to look exactly the same, because we want it to be 12 by 12, right? We want it to be exactly square. If you didn't want it to be square, of course, you could change the value of the top of the loop on one of these. Now, here is the magic question, that $64,000 question is, what goes here? Well, we know we need to display something. What do we need to display? Well, we need to multiply the two things and display their output. So we know we're going to take whatever is in the first loop's variable, a row, and multiply it by whatever's in the second loop's loop variable, which is the column. And then that's going to be our multiplication table. Well, you know, not quite. We have a mistake. Now, we don't have a mistake in calculations, but as you're going to see, we're going to have a mistake in output. So now let me call this multiplication table. Let's do a simple 1, 5. Have I made any of my typical mistakes? No, I have all my colons in place. That's fine. So let's run it and let's see what we get. Okay, max num is not defined. Okay, so what have I done wrong here? Max num is not defined. Blah, blah, blah. Of course, let's see. I have typed it incorrectly by case. All right, that's a good bug to find and fix, isn't it? Okay, check your casing. It makes a difference. All right, so, well, I get the numbers, but they look awful. All right, that's not what we want at all. What I want to do is I want to make sure that all of these things that are printed for this column go in one line, right? We don't want them on separate lines. So what do I have to do here? Well, I have to, instead of putting a new line separator, I have to go with something like this at the end of each one. Okay? So that I get the values on one line instead of on every single one on a different line. But now we have a new problem. That's good, except, well, first of all, they're smushed together, and second of all of them are on one line, and that's not quite what I wanted. What I really want is all of the ones for a single row on one line, but then all the ones for the next row on a different line. So how do I do that? I can't do it in here, because in here I'm still printing column values. But notice that right here I'm done printing the column stuff, and I'm ready for a new row. So I can just do this. Right, because that's going to default to printing nothing, but it will do a new line at the end. So that will do the moving to the next line, so I get a table that looks a little bit better. Okay, well, it doesn't look a lot better, so that's not great. So what do I want to do about that? Stop and think, what's a good solution here? Well, because the numbers are going to be different sizes, maybe I want to use the clever built-in formatting thing that Python offers, right? The formatting specifier. So instead of just printing the plain stuff, why don't I instead format and then do the multiplication, but then use a width specifier so that I say, wow, all the numbers should take up, I don't know, how many characters do you want? We got to leave space in here, right? So I'm going to do 5, and then these are integers, so I can use a D here, not an F as we've seen in some other places, maybe. D for integer, decimal, you know, a digit. So there we go. Each one's going to take up 5 spaces. Let's see if this looks better. Invalid syntax. Okay, what have I forgotten? I've forgotten to close my parentheses. Okay, there we go. And let's go again. Okay, what have I forgotten here? Format takes no keyword arguments. Okay, well, the place I put my close parentheses is wrong. I need to finish my format command in here, and this end goes with the print command, so I didn't finish my business. I was too quick in putting my extra parentheses here. This is an iterative process. You find and debug and get rid of the problems, and then you move on. Hope that you're done. I have a feeling that this is better. Yay, look how pretty that looks. That looks pretty darn good. 4 is maybe a little bit big, or you know, 5 spaces, but that's okay. Let's try it now with the bigger multiplication table. This is the one I learned. Let's try and see how this looks. Wow, look at that. So that looks great. Now, one can imagine doing something to do row headers and column headers. So if you want to get fancy, that's a great iterative improvement that you want to make on that solution. But I will leave that for an exercise for you if you wish to tackle that. So stop here. Type this in if you want. Ponder it a little bit, and we'll move on. And actually moving on in this case means we're finally done. I know that's a lot of video minutes for you, but since we don't have classroom time together, I wanted to give you this mini lecture on looping. It's a powerful, important concept. There's a lot of little gotchas and little things to learn, so hopefully by working through these examples, you understand more fully how this works and you've got better insight into how to do your programs more correctly. So hope you enjoyed these, and we will talk to you soon. Thanks for watching this video.